Hello and welcome to The Wrap, a review of some of the most important, intriguing, strange, and inspirational news happenings from the past few weeks. Up front in this edition, the mess in Washington over Obamacare and the debt limit, which had ground much of the federal government to a screeching halt. Now, the shutdown finally ended after 18 days, but Congress merely approved a temporary measure to keep the government running. So it's very likely we're going to have the same chaotic mess a few months from now. Of course, this is all the manifestation of the dysfunctional relationship between the White House and Republicans and Democrats in Congress. It has been a political tug of war of epic proportions between Republican lawmakers led by House Speaker John Boehner and the Democrats led by President Barack Obama.
American people expect when their leaders have differences and we're in a time of crisis that we'll sit down and at least have a conversation.
We cannot do that under the threat that if Republicans don't get 100% of their way, they're going to either shut down the government or they are going to default on America's debt.
On October 1st, closed for business signs were up in front of federal facilities across the nation. For some, it was cause for laughter and lampooning.
Congress needs to keep our government open, needs to pay our bills on time, and never ever threaten the full faith and credit of the United States of America. And time's running out. My hope and expectation is that in the 11th hour, once again, that Congress will choose to do the right thing, and that the House of Representatives in particular will choose the right thing.
But for this group of veterans from Iowa, the shutdown, which included the World War II Memorial in Washington, prompted frustration and anger.
The last thing we should see in America is a barricade for World War II veterans to be prevented from coming to their memorial.
One of the more disturbing of the consequences of the shutdown, a suspension of immediate death benefits paid to survivors of troops killed in action overseas.
Line to protect our democracy. I'm sorry, how dare they? Yesterday, I saw several congressmen and senators just blow this off. Oh, we're going to take care of it. No, they're not.
Fortunately, a deal was worked out with a private charity loaning the money to the government for those payouts to military survivors.
Everybody's talking at me. I don't hear words saying.
Politicians on both sides of the aisle in the House and Senate have been talking a lot about not talking.
The American people have given us divided government. And when you have divided government, it means you have to talk to each other.
I mean, what I've said is that I will talk about anything.
They have refused to even consider the compromise that we have offered.
They won't even negotiate with us on anything.
What have the Democrats compromised on? Nothing.
Harry Reid will not negotiate with John Boehner. The president will not meet with John Boehner.
The president refuses to compromise on anything.
The non-talk talk from Republicans and Democrats has been over reopening the government, raising the debt limit, and funding for the new health care program known as Obamacare.
I say that big talk's worth doodly squat.
Speaking of Obamacare, Republican Congressman John Fleming from Louisiana called it the most dangerous law in U.S. history.
Going back to when legislation approved slavery and all of that, this is even and more dangerous than that.
Yeah, this affects millions. In fact, it's going to affect probably every single American. It covers 1/6 of the economy.
You are talking about the nonsensical ravings of a lunatic mind.
And that's insanity, what's going on over there.
An effort by Republicans to block Obamacare from taking full effect is at the heart of the political showdown which caused the government shutdown.
If we take care of vital government priorities this week, and then going forward we negotiate a compromise that mitigates, that prevents the harms Obamacare is causing to millions of Americans, that will be a real victory for the American people.
You don't get resolution unless people sit at the table, work together, and try to bridge these divides.
No bridge! There's no divide! It's a law! What? I don't understand this!
those who will not live by the law shall die by the law.
To some degree, Republicans are right to say, "I told you so," about Obamacare. The computer system put in place to handle registration for the health insurance marketplace at the center of the Affordable Care Law has had major technical problems, glitches that have been plaguing the system from day one on October 1st.
And there's no excuse for the problems. And these problems are getting fixed. But while we're working out the kinks in the system, I want everybody to understand the nature of the problem.
Yeah, they set up this website. They hire
3 years.
They've had years to do it. They hire these so-called great professionals, and it's a total disaster.
The new health insurance exchanges are expected to enroll about 7 million Americans in 2014. Since we're on the subject of disasters, let's turn our attention back to Congress. What used to be referred to as the world's leading deliberative body is now being called, and rightly so, the Do-Nothing Congress. The current session, the 113th in the nation's history, is on track to be the least productive ever, even worse than the 112th Congress, which, up till now, holds that distinction. Quick now, give me the name of any significant piece of legislation passed by Congress in 2013 and sent to the president for his signature. Give up? If you couldn't think of any, you're right.
Without objection, a motion to reconsider is laid on the table.
Only 22 bills have left Congress and made it to the White House so far this year, less than the 28 passed by this time during last year's session, and none of any real significance. This Congress has trouble even passing a resolution to maintain funding to keep the government running. Is it any wonder that Congress is about as popular with the American people as root canals and colonoscopies?
Just today, a new poll came out. What do you have a higher opinion of, Congress or dog poop? Congress, 40%, dog poop, 47%.
Unemployment is still a big problem in America. So, too, is the nation's crumbling infrastructure, roads, bridges, the electrical grid, and the like. Think Congress could come up with legislation to improve the first problem by addressing the latter? Nope. Seems some lawmakers would rather spend time reading nursery rhymes.
Do you like green eggs and ham? I do not like them, Sam I am. I do not like green eggs and ham.
Congress has become so divisive, so dysfunctional. Some of the few remaining voices of reason there have taken to making emotional appeals for civility, a la police beating victim Rodney King during the 1992 L.A. riots.
You know, can we all get along? Can we get along?
Stop attacking each other and impugning people's integrity and honor.
Recently, I was in the newsroom reading a story about a just-released public opinion poll. It found that only about 25% of American voters want their own congressperson to be reelected. It got me to daydreaming about how great it would be to make a clean sweep of this Congress, just blow the whole thing up. Well, not literally, but it would be nice if someone with magical powers could just make this current bunch of congressional lawmakers disappear. Ah, what a pleasant thought. But I guess it's back to reality, and the fact that our Congress in some ways resembles the TV news business, as described by the writer and social critic Hunter S. Thompson, who called modern television journalism a cruel and shallow money trench, a long plastic hallway where thieves and pimps run free, and good men die like dogs. Certainly, we can complain about Congress, but as they say in Latin, caveat emptor, let the buyer beware. The truth is, we're getting what we voted for. There are few things in life more predictable than an incumbent member of Congress winning re-election. Since 1964, the re-election rate for members of the House has been about 95%. The Senate side just slightly lower at 85%. So much for our ineffective Congress. Let's talk about the crook who used to run the city of Detroit. The sad saga of former Mayor Kwame Kilpatrick came to an end recently when a federal judge sentenced him on his conviction for a host of corruption charges. For the former so-called hip-hop mayor, the year 2041 holds great significance. That's when he'll once again be a free man following the 28-year prison term given him by Judge Nancy Edmonds, the stiffest sentence ever given for political corruption in America. But the judge called it appropriate since Kilpatrick was found guilty of running a criminal enterprise out of the mayor's office. Another city government ripoff artist, Robert Rizzo, the former city manager of the town of Bell, California, is waiting to learn his sentence after pleading no contest to 69 counts of corruption. Rizzo was the ringleader of a pack of thieves, including five former elected city officials. They cooked the books so that the lower middle class town of 35,000 people paid some, like Rizzo, up to $1.5 million a year, about triple what President Obama makes for running the country. It is both a sin and a shame, incidents of violence and theft in places of worship. Here in the U.S., though violent crimes, burglaries, and thefts have gone down the past few years, just the opposite is true in the nation's churches. According to the Christian Security Network, robberies from churches have increased nearly 50% in recent years, costing churches more than $7 million in losses. The rise in violence, much more alarming. A decade ago, there were only 10 documented incidents of church violence in the U.S. In 2007, that number had risen to 41. And last year, there were at least 135 incidents. Overseas, the carnage is much worse, with thousands of shootings and bombings at places of worship over the last few years. It was just last month that two suicide bombers set off explosions, killing nearly 100 worshippers at a Christian church in Peshawar, Pakistan. 2 days earlier, 15 people were killed at a mosque in the city of Samarra in Iraq. August 14th and 15th of this year, there were simultaneous attacks launched by Muslim terrorists at more than 50 churches across Egypt. Also in that country, at a New Year's Eve Mass in 2010, 21 people died when a suicide bomber struck the All Saints Church in Alexandria.
It was very bloody. I saw blood in this church because you see this church, and next to the church there's a hospital, and between the church and the hospital there are stairs that lead to the hospital. It's all covered with blood.
Further south on the African continent, 17 people, including three children, died in the June 2012 bombing of a church in Garissa, Kenya. The Jewish Defense League says so far in the 21st century there have been 51 attacks on synagogues around the world. Back in this country, most of the violence in our houses of worship involves shootings or stabbings. Just weeks ago, on September 27th, the pastor at the Tabernacle of Praise Worship Center in Lake Charles, Louisiana, was shot and killed as he was preaching.
Witnesses told police Carey walked into the church, shot the pastor once, then again at close range, after Harris had fallen to the floor. He then fled the scene.
August 5th of last year, a racist nut job burst into the Sikh temple near Milwaukee and murdered six temple goers. One of the worst of the nation's church shootings taking place in December 2007, when 13 people were shot in the sanctuary of the New Life Church in Colorado Springs. Four of those people died.
The gunman opened fire in this parking lot on the east side of the church, shooting five people. One died at the scene. So did the gunman, who was shot by a church security guard.
A courageous security staff member who probably saved many lives today.
In March of 2009, the pastor of a small church in southern Illinois near St. Louis was killed and two of his members stabbed by the same assailant.
I have to go back to scripture and know that this event, like all events, will pass. This too shall pass.
At a church in Knoxville, Tennessee, July 27, 2008, two people died and seven were hurt when a crazy man opened fire during a youth musical performance. Why did he do it? He claims he disagreed with the church's liberal teachings. The wave of violence in America's churches have made church leaders much more security conscious, and increasingly church personnel have been going to security seminars like this one held in Houston. and taking part in on-site training scenarios, such as this one at a church in Richmond, Virginia.
It's an unfortunate sign of our times. The churches can no longer afford to simply place their faith in God, but must also place it in security guards to focus attention on weapons as well as worship, to be concerned with saving lives along with saving souls.
In May of last year, an on-duty security guard fell victim to violence. 84-year-old Joseph Lewis was killed while on guard in the parking lot at a church on the west side of Detroit.
It is alleged that the defendant Boone and Williams approached Mr. Lewis and a physical altercation ensued. The suspect fired shots, fatally wounding him.
My family is relieved. We're still saddened by everything that happened. We don't understand why.
While more and more churches have security personnel on hand at services and other church functions, many are still unprepared for a violent attack. According to the National Organization of Church Safety and Security Management, 70% of America's houses of worship have no kind of security force or even a safety plan. I'll have more on the subject of violence in church a bit later in our commentary segment, My Two Cents. But coming up next on The Wrap, a homeless man in Boston does the right thing and is being rewarded big time for it. And we'll take another look at boxing champ Muhammad Ali, but from a different perspective. If you're like me, you might not like what you see.
Fast! Last night I cut the light off in my bedroom, hit the switch, was in the bed before the room was dark.
Incredible.
Fast!
This week in history for the time period October 16th through the 22nd. Unlike Joan of Arc, it's a cold chop rather than a hot steak for Queen Marie Antoinette. She literally loses her head by guillotine during the French Revolution. The worst earthquake in 82 years strikes the San Francisco Bay Area, minutes before the start of a World Series game there. The earthquake registers 6.9 on the Richter scale. 67 are killed and damage estimated at $10 billion. American athletes Tommy Smith and John Carlos suspended by the U.S. Olympic Committee for giving the Black Power salute while receiving their medals at the Olympic Games in Mexico City. Major General Lord Cornwallis surrenders to George Washington at Yorktown, Virginia, and as a result, the Revolutionary War is effectively ended. The first donut is fried by Salvation Army volunteer women for American troops in France during World War I. President Theodore Roosevelt incites controversy by inviting a black man, educator and activist Booker T. Washington, to the White House. After 14 months of testing, Thomas Edison first demonstrates his electric lamp, hoping to one day compete with gaslight. And it was during this week that Cardinal Karol Wojtyla is inaugurated as the new head of the Roman Catholic Church. The Polish-born Wojtyla would take the name Pope John Paul II, becoming the first non-Italian pope in 450 years. He would go on to exert considerable influence on events during the last quarter of the 20th century and become the second longest-serving pope in the history of the papacy. Like many of my generation, I've been a big-time fan of former heavyweight boxing champ Muhammad Ali. He literally shook up the world with his actions and his words. Several months ago, I had an opportunity to finally view an extraordinary documentary from HBO Productions entitled The Thriller in Manila. It was a somewhat different look at Ali from the eyes of his arch-rival Joe Frazier and from others. It prompted me to do a bit more research, and I must say that as a result, my glowing opinion of Ali has lost some of its luster.
I am the greatest.
He was bold, brash, bombastic, and could box his butt off. Floating like a butterfly, stinging like a bee. There was no one on earth quite like Muhammad Ali.
I am the king of the world.
Hold it. You're not that pretty.
I'm a bad man. Wait. I shook up the world.
Ali was a lot more than simply a terrific heavyweight boxer. In most every sense of the word, he was a cultural icon. During his heyday, probably the most famous man on the planet.
Only last week, I murdered a rock, injured a stone, hospitalized a brick. I'm so mean, I make medicine sick.
Bad dude.
Bad.
But these days, 32 years after his last boxing match, Ali is losing his toughest fight with Parkinson's disease, a progressive, incurable ailment that has transformed the greatest to an invalid, a human thoroughbred now trapped inside a body which has short-circuited.
For everyone to watch, but one thing we have to remember is that everything that happens is what God meant to happen.
Ali's number one rival in the ring, Joe Frazier, feels the same about Ali's condition being God's will, though Frazier feels it's more like God's punishment.
Whatever you've done when you're a young man, it comes to bite you in the butt when you get old. Trust me.
So do you think he's paying the price for what he did as a young man?
And said, that's right. God marks it down.
This is the story of the other man in Manila, a man unable to let go of the bitterest and most intense sporting rivalry ever seen.
The 2008 HBO documentary, Thrilla in Manila, showed a rather embittered Frazier relating a story about helping Ali in the late 60s, when he, Ali, had lost his boxing license for refusing induction into the Army during the war in Vietnam.
A determined Joe Frazier traveled to Washington to petition for Ali's right to fight.
At the time, it was President Nixon, I think, involved. So, president. And I went over and talked to him. He said, Joe, you want me to have a license? He got it.
When his license was reinstated, how did Ali repay Frazier's kindness? By portraying Frazier as dumb.
Joe Frazier's just an ordinary individual. He don't represent nothing. He's not intelligent, if you will.
As ape-like.
Come on, gorilla. We in Manila.
Joe Frazier!
I have a secret place I go to get ready for Joe Frazier. Every day I go to the zoo.
And as an Uncle Tom, a traitor to his black race.
He's the other type Negro. He's not like me. There's two type slaves. Joe Frazier's worse than you to me. That's what I mean when I say Uncle Tom. See, he's a brother. One day he might be like me, but as of now, he works for the enemy.
Ali's comments degrading Frazier's commitment to his race and making him out to be a white man in blackface are perhaps the height of hypocrisy. Since Ali admits in an interview inserted in the documentary that he was once chummy with the Ku Klux Klan, the most vile and vicious anti-black hate group in American history.
Ali even spoke at a Klan rally, and ahead of the fight in Manila, boasted about the experience.
Hell of a scene. All these white hoods on, the bonfire, and me on the platform, and all these Klans was talking. I says, black people should marry their own women. I said, bluebirds with bluebirds, redbirds with redbirds, pigeons with pigeons, eagles with eagles. God didn't make no mistake. They say, yeah! They said, well, you teach the rest of them niggers that, everything will be all right.
In his prime, Muhammad Ali was unquestionably the greatest as a fighter and as a showman. But as a human being, I think a careful review of his record places him, at least in my eyes, many rungs below the level of greatness.
Joe Frazier did seem to be conflicted about Ali's serious health challenges. In another interview done after the HBO documentary, Frazier choked back tears when talking about Ali's affliction, how it pained him to see how his once supremely able adversary had his body so ravaged by Parkinson's. 2 years ago, despite his fragile condition, Ali made it to Philadelphia for the funeral of Joe Frazier, who died in November 2011 of liver cancer. Prosecutors in New York City are still trying to figure out whether to file charges against the owner of an unmanned aircraft that went on a flight of fancy recently over Manhattan.
Look, up in the sky, it's a bird.
It's a plane.
It's Superman. Yes, it's Superman.
Actually, it was a helicopter drone, which took off from a high-rise terrace in Midtown Manhattan. WABC-TV was able to get this exclusive video of the drone's flight. It happened during the evening rush hour a couple of weeks ago. After a flight lasting about 15 minutes, the drone crash landed a few feet away from a businessman who was trying to catch a subway train. The tiny radio-operated drone weighs only 3 pounds and costs less than $500. However, the FAA considers it an unmanned aircraft, subject to aviation safety regulations. In news from around the globe, there is a growing problem on the Mediterranean seas. Boats packed with migrants fleeing from desperately poor African nations like Somalia. On October 5th, a boat ferrying an estimated 500 migrants sank off the Italian island of Lampedusa. The official death toll has been put at 300. The captain of the boat remains in jail in Sicily and could be charged with manslaughter. There have been a number of boating tragedies recently involving migrants crossing the Mediterranean from parts of Africa. The European Commission is proposing beefed-up search and rescue patrols to intercept the boats. In Mexico, a monster truck became a monster in fact, plowing into a crowd of spectators, killing 8 and injuring 79. It happened at a makeshift arena in a park in the city of Chihuahua. Government officials and organizers of the event are blaming the driver of the truck for losing control and smashing into the crowd. Motorsports experts say the event was a disaster waiting to happen. They say the setup of the state-sponsored truck show was blatantly deficient and life-threatening. My dad used to have a saying, right is right and right don't wrong nobody. Well, Pops, you'd be awfully proud of a homeless man named Glenn James. Back in September, he found something at the South Bay Shopping Mall in suburban Boston. It was a backpack, and inside was a passport, $2,400 in cash, and nearly $40,000 in traveler's checks. James, who'd been living in a homeless shelter, immediately turned the bag into police so it could be returned to its rightful owner. End of the story? Not quite. The Boston Police Department, perhaps pleasantly surprised by the honesty of this down-on-his-luck man, honored him with a special citation. And then a man in Virginia, Ethan Whittington, a complete stranger, read about James's selflessness and launched an online fundraising campaign. As of the taping of this edition of The Wrap, nearly $160,000 had come in. Money to fund a life overhaul for Glenn James, a man who is proof positive that honesty is the best policy. Well, there's more to come on The Wrap. I'm going to give you my 2 cents on the growing menace of violence in church. You'll find out why this portrait of Jesus cost a small school district nearly $100,000. And we'll take you for a tour of the land of the rising sun in our Sights and Sounds segment. Well, folks, it's time to check this out. According to officials with toy and game maker Hasbro, more Monopoly money is made each year than all the real money printed worldwide. When glass breaks, the cracks move faster than 3,000 miles an hour. To photograph the event, a camera must shoot at a millionth of a second. Did you know almost half the newspapers in the world are published either in the U.S. or Canada? And check this. An East Texas man, Reggie Theus, recently checked his bank account and to his surprise discovered the balance was over $4 trillion. But unfortunately, the balance, which would have made Theus the world's first trillionaire, was caused by a bank error, so he was unable to withdraw the money and close out his account. By the way, if you were to count out that amount of money by $1 every second, 24 hours a day, it would take you nearly 127,000 years to reach $4 trillion. Earlier in this program, we had a story about violence in churches and other places of worship. It's a very disturbing trend. Over the past decade or so, we've seen a significant increase in the number of incidents of shootings and stabbings in what are supposed to be places of love, peace, and reverence. A decade ago, there were only 10 incidents of church violence reported in America. By last year, that figure had risen to 135. Why? How can it be that there is such defilement in what's supposed to be God's house? It seems we can no longer depend even on our places of worship to be safe havens from murder and mayhem. In more and more churches these days, money is being taken from the collection plate to pay for security personnel, for alarm systems, and for high-tech locks on the doors to church administrative offices. Again, it begs the question, why? And it makes me wonder about all those verses in the Bible about God's protection, such as Isaiah 54:17, which declares, "No weapon that is fashioned against you shall succeed." In Psalm 121:7, where it's written, "The Lord will keep you from all evil." I've always read and heard that God is omnipotent, all-powerful, that with God any good and righteous thing is possible. I wonder if that's really true in these days and times. Could it be there are things which God cannot do, which are beyond even His ability to intercede, to influence? Now, some of you may consider it blasphemous even for me to pose the question, but I believe that doubt about some aspects of God is not a negative. On the contrary, to the very fiber of my being, I agree with the sentiments of Brian Jones, written in his book, Second Guessing God, Hanging On When You Can't See His Plan. Pastor Jones writes that doubt is a natural part of Christian life, and that Jesus uses people who struggle with doubt to change the world. Indeed, in the Bible it's written that the closest followers of Christ, his disciples, expressed uncertainty from time to time. In a boat during a storm on the lake, written about in the 14th chapter of Matthew, Peter was doubtful even when he saw Jesus walking on water.
Come!
No! Don't go, Simon!
I meant to go!
You of little faith.
Just before the Great Commission, when the disciples first see the resurrected Christ, Matthew writes, "They saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted." So anyway, let's get back to the issue at hand, the shocking increase in violence in places of worship here in America and around the world. Is it possible that God can't put a stop to it? That it's beyond his power even to prevent some evil or crazy person from walking into a church sanctuary and firing a gun or setting off an explosion? Could it be that as our world has evolved, so too has the very nature of God? Without question, or at least it's my belief, God works small miracles every day in the lives of individual people. But I wonder if the Lord is still capable of doing the big stuff, like the parting of the Red Sea written about in the book of Exodus.
Behold his mighty hand!
If God really had the power to intercede, would he not have prevented or stopped the monstrosity of slavery in America? Wouldn't he have prevented the Holocaust, rescued 6 million Jews from Nazi gas chambers?
He's God. Blessed be the name of his glorious kingdom, forever and ever.
There is no place on earth that I love being in more than in church. It has always been my safe harbor from the stormy seas that I've sometimes been confronted with in life. Why is it that church then is no longer a place where we can be assured of safety, of protection from the evil out there in the world? Or is that asking too much? Certainly not in my mind. I don't yet have any answers, but I'm going to keep on asking the questions and continuing to pray that God will someday provide me the answers to shine His light in all of the dark places, give me absolute clarity to rid me of lingering doubts. If or when He does, I promise I'll let you know. And that is my two cents for this week.
When the rap continues, we'll have a special piece in honor of Pastor Appreciation Month. But first, a word from the Word.
Come on.
I'm not sure how many of you realized it, but this month, October, is National Clergy Appreciation Month, a time for Christians to express special gratitude for their church leaders. It got me to thinking about the pastors who've had a special impact on my life and how they've done it.
First and foremost, I think a pastor has to be a very skilled teacher of the word. Charisma is good, a bit of show business is great for the church business, but solid doctrine, an ability to boldly and clearly articulate the Word of God and make it meaningful in the lives of his or her congregants is key.
We've come to a generation where we're trying to modify Scripture to fit our living. The spirit of this age is so delusional, and it is so powerful, so seductive. It is my belief that if there's ever been a time that we need to stand up strong, it's right now.
Also, a pastor needs to be a person who's genuinely servant-hearted, loves caring for people, and reflecting the light of Christ on all he or she comes into contact with.
If the church is going to help the community, the church has got to be the church. We have enough social clubs already. We have enough nightclubs in the community, enough liquor stores, enough. We don't need no more McDonald's. Have enough McDonald's. What the community needs is a church. It was one Richard who said that the church does the world the most good when the church is least like the world.
Exceptional pastors are visionaries and overseers. They lead with intellect, spiritual instinct, strength, and humility.
Dox means doctrine, straight doctrine. That's what orthodox means. You got correct doctrine. But there's a second word that is equally as important. It's called orthopraxy, which means straight experience or practice. In other words, you can have the doctrine, you must be born again, and never be born again, so you don't have the orthopraxy. You've got orthodoxy, but not orthopraxy, and that's what happened to me. I went to catechism when I was a kid. I believed all the right things, but if my heart were to quit beating, I would have landed in the dungeons of the damned to await the great white throne judgment, because my orthodoxy was not orthopraxy.
And of course, the best pastors tend to be great family men with amazing wives, folks who truly practice what they preach, with loving, Christ-centered home lives, and are people with high standards of personal integrity and decorum.
Pastors Williams, Young, and Oldfield are three of my very favorite clergymen, gifted preachers who handle the very demanding job of spiritual advisor, mentor, and leader with extraordinary skill. But the greatest preacher that I've ever known happens to be the man I'm named after, my maternal grandfather, Reverend Otis Warren, who at the time of his death was pastor of the New Hope Baptist Church in Dangerfield, Texas. Up next, we're going to put the wraps on this edition of The Wrap with a trip across Japan in Sights and Sounds. Finally, we're going to take you to the land of cherry blossoms, high-tech gadgets, and sushi for our Sights and Sounds segment. Japan is a country I have rather intimate knowledge of. As a U.S. Navy journalist, I spent 2 years there in the mid-70s. To me, it was an enigmatic place, both very strange and yet in ways rather familiar. So, as we show you the glitz and glitter of Tokyo, the majesty of Mount Fuji, and the beauty of places like Nijo Castle in Kyoto, we'll also listen to the sounds of the incredible jazz fusion group Hiroshima. Thank you. And that's a wrap for this edition of The Wrap. Until next time, y'all be blessed and all the rest. Ta-ta.